Hey guys, welcome to this 350Z or 350Z video. And today is a special video because I'm gonna call this a nerd out session. So if you're looking for any mechanical stuff, we're not gonna do it today. But today we're going to talk about things that I find interesting that a lot of people that are getting into these cars or may already own the cars might not know about it. In this video, we're kind of focusing on little quirks and cool key features of the vehicle. Now, I am not a Nissan technician, I don't work for Nissan, so there might be some things I might be overviewing, so please comment below if you have anything else cool to add. The VQ is an engine that's been around for quite some time. It came out in the mid-90s, roughly around 1994. It really made a reputation for itself in the Maximas, having good power and its amazing refinement that had. It was silky smooth. Now, in the 350, they traded a little bit of refinement for power, because you might notice that the power numbers jumped quite a bit, even in 2003. So those are things that they tried to bring back with the HR, and they really tried to bring back the refinement with the 370Z. This engine is what Nissan likes to call their front midship. So technically, in some ways, the way the waste is distributed, we can kind of call it a mid-engine car. I'm really stretching that term right here. But they did push the motor as far back as they can for weight distribution. Now it has a 53-47 split. Now a lot of you are going to say that's not a true 50-50 car. Correct. Now there's different reasons why what Nissan says is they prefer this weight distribution because when you brake, there's more weight that's going to go on top of the front tires, giving you more grip during a corner. But then when you exit, that weight distribution becomes 50-50 with the weight going back during acceleration. That's their claim on things, which makes a lot of sense. So they might be saying that because they truly designed it that way, or they said that way because we can't really push the motor back anymore. This is as good as it's going to get. The only way to make this truly 50-50 is to add more weight to the car. Let's just mark it this way. Take it for what it is, but it does make sense either way. I also want to quickly mention that there actually is a 380 RS. This was their production race car version. I guess they had to make a couple of these cars to compete. I don't know much about it. I watched a couple of videos on it. It's pretty neat. So if you guys are interested in it, there is a 350 or a Z or Z33 platform with an engine that's 3.8 liters in displacement and designed for racing. So that's a neat one that not a lot of people know about this platform. Okay, first quirk. First, we open up the gas cap. I'm not trying to give a plug that I'm an installer or anything. Now, what happens when we fill up the fuel? This is what I used to do for the longest time when I first bought the car. I would pay at the pump, get the pump, and I would just hold this guy right here and not know what to do with myself. There's actually a hook on the door, and then you just put it on there. And now you have two hands free. Driver ergonomics are huge for the 350 design. Now, I do have a video in my 350Z playlist where if you look for the Japanese videos where they were talking about the car when it first debuted, they go over in much more detail about this than I am in this video. But there are some cool, interesting things. Now, yes, the gauge layout is really cool with the tack in the center. That's the one that's the most important. And all the supplementary gauges on the center of the dash that makes sense to have. As a true driver, you're going to really appreciate having that. But what I like is the seating position and your eye line. When Nissan developed this car, they were very in tune with drivers and they tried to find the optimal seating position and with the windshield, the way everything's laid out, to reduce driver fatigue. Now, if you drive this car, you'll realize you do sit low. It's a sports car, but their visibility in front is very good. The A-pillars, even though they are large, the way that they're raked back, they don't really get in your way when you're driving for traffic or anything. Cars like the Corvette and the Viper, they're awesome on a twisty road, but I find for city driving, they're not optimized in that way. Now, the 350 is plagued as a typical sports car. The rear quarters are very hard to see out of. You have to use your mirrors. You got to lean forward to look, check your blind spots. And looking out the back window, it's pretty useless. I have a backup camera on mine, which makes life a lot easier. But when you're driving in the city and you're driving on twisty roads, you can really appreciate how they set up this car. And you can drive this car for hours and hours. And it's not tiresome at all. All 350s except for the base are equipped with a viscous limited slip. Also, the factory muffler has an aero piece on it. Now, most of us remove it. I'd have noticed the difference, but it might be a part or essential to their zero lift design. In true sports car fashion, there's no accessible glove box in the front. The glove box is located behind the passenger. However, there is one little compartment. This compartment is typically for business cards, but I just like to call it the business section because you either fit your business cards or you probably fit about 2 to 3 condoms in there, no problem. Rev up motors found in the 2005 Anniversary Edition and any manual transmission in 2006 are known for oil consumption. HR owners don't have to deal with oil consumption like rev up owners, but what they do have to deal with is a poor design on the slave cylinder for the clutch, and they have to spend a little bit of money to correct it. Nissan really liked to flaunt their new interior in 2006. It had nice aluminum bits in it, and it had a little bit of a redesign, some tweaks. However, from 2003 to 2005, the materials seem to be a little bit better. And in a G35, they actually have much better materials in that interior compared to the 350. Infiniti spent more money on their interior materials, while Nissan spent more money on their suspension. The 350 suspension components are mainly composed of forged aluminum bits when it comes to their A-arms and other parts like that, while on the G35 you'll notice that they use more steel components. And also the 350, if you look at the vehicles from underneath, has a lot more bracing, not just from the interior with that big where the speaker is and that rear strut tire bar. There is a lot more bracing underneath the 350. Those are reasons why the 350 probably handles better, because it is a lot more rigid of a car. Not to say that the G35 isn't rigid, but the 350 is significantly more rigid than that car. And also, because they use a lot of forged aluminum parts, the unsprung weight, the vehicle can react a lot quicker than a G35 can.
And here's a view of some of those forged aluminum parts.
In the aftermarket world, cool is king. And when it comes to security systems, there are people out there that want to have more. Now, on the aftermarket, there are window modules available. What you might not know about this car is they're actually built in. So you save yourself a little bit on hardware, but you have to have someone that's competent enough to be able to wire into the system. Now, you might say, the 350, you can roll the windows down through the remote. Yes, you can. But on the factory remote, you can't roll them back up. The 350's hatch is powered. You can hit a button from outside or you can hit the remote. What a lot of people don't know is, because I know a lot of you are watching this video because you don't like to read the owner's manual, underneath, Velcroed is a little hook. Pull that to the side and you can open up the rear hatch. I truly believe that there is some sort of law in the car industry saying that if you build a sports car, you have to put some sort of BS feature into it. And when it comes to things, that should just be really easy or functional. When it comes to the gas lid, you may notice that it's power. You can either hit a button inside, which is the only way if it's stock, or if you are like me, you wire it up that you can hit it from the remote and open it. But either way, what happens if that motor dies, or if a fuse pops and that motor is related to that circuit? How do you fuel up the vehicle? Well, Nissan has actually made a way to open it up manually. The catch is you have to remove a lot of the interior to get at it. Because I like you guys so much, I disassembled a bunch of my interior to get at it. So you have to remove the rear portion plastic and the top portion, because that carpet is not really carpet. It's like an injected molded plastic. It is a composite material, but it's like in between carpet and plastic. So it has no give. If you could force your way in there, but if you did, you're going to crack it or you're going to see the seam after. So I highly recommend you don't do that if you like your car. So to do it properly, we have to remove all this trim, because all of us carry trim release panel tools in the vehicle, right? So you've taken apart all this, and even then, unless you remove the covers on the strut tower brace, this still has like no give. Now hopefully you guys can see it. I'm not joking, this is a thing. Not a very good thing, sorry. Okay, so you see there's this guy right here, so gas cap closed. Now on part of it, there's a little white little pin at the top. You just pull that back. So I'm gonna pull on it. Now it's open. Let's do it again for you. No camera tricks, no one's inside the car or anything. You can take this apart and figure out for yourself. I'm gonna pull on it, it opens up. So if this motor failed and you're in the middle of nowhere and you need to fill up your vehicle with fuel, you should have a panel release tool. Familiarize yourself with how to take this all apart just so you can grab it. Now I might rig up a little string or a wire somewhere that I can pull on it, because that would have been the smart thing to do. You see how they did on the strut tower brace? They routed that cable all the way through back here. Well, if they just gave us a little access panel back here, maybe I'll just make an access panel actually. Put a little access panel back here so you can pull on it. No one cares. The 350Z interior sucks. Who cares if there's an access panel and it looks a little bit quote unquote ugly? At least in an emergency situation, you can open that up easier. In the back right corner of the storage compartment, if you lift up the floor, there is enough room to keep 1 liter of oil nicely tucked away that's not going to move around when you're driving, when you're doing some spirited driving. Nissan is primarily concerned about you getting to the golf course with this vehicle as opposed to traveling, so they have detailed instructions how to store 2 golf bags in this vehicle.
The rear diff carrier bushing is known for going bad over time. If you want to buy a new bushing, Nissan wants you to buy a whole new subframe. Buy aftermarket. And buy polyurethane. Nissan installs a factory ground on the exhaust. Now, there are different arguments to why it's there. I'm going to say mainly for, I don't know, some people say corrosion, other people say for sound, other people say for possibly engine noise. I've talked to several people about it. I really need to talk to a Nissan engineer, but I decided, well, if you put a factory ground there, I'm just going to put a bigger one on then.
At slow speeds, moving different directions, whether going forward or backwards, you might hear a clicking noise from your axle shaft. This can be corrected with blue thread lock and cleaning it.
The factory drive shaft is made of carbon fiber or a composite material, and this is standard across all the models as far as I know. I actually had one person, when I was trying to buy a 350, tell me that theirs is a special edition and has a carbon fiber drive shaft, and I tried telling them that even the enthusiast like my car is equipped with this drive shaft, and they didn't believe me. Well, this is an enthusiast, and that's a carbon fiber drive shaft.
One of the key design features of building the 350 when Nissan was designing it was to use a lot of off-the-shelf parts. That helps keep costs down, and if you're trying to change out parts, you can just have a plethora of parts to pick from because there's so many vehicles that Nissan makes. Nissan has big, heavy steel doors, so I guess they decided to use the same hangers off a Nissan Sentra because the bushings blow out all the time with these big, heavy doors. In North America, and maybe some other parts of the world, we know that the 350 doesn't have the best interior. A lot of the parts were painted. And in my video, a lot of you vocalized that you didn't like my painting job on my door handle trim. Now, this is my theory behind it. I did do another video where I used regular paint that seemed to make people happier. The reason why I use bed liner is because it still looks the same. You're using some sort of flat black or gloss, regular paint, grabbing it all the time, I'm pretty sure you're going to have the exact same problem again. The only way to really truly correct it is maybe get some carbon fiber bits. Now, why is my reason that I use the bed liner? It's kind of like having a girlfriend in some ways. I'd rather have a girl that looks like a 7 or an 8 who's awesome, and she's going to look like a 7 or an 8 till she's 60. I don't want to have a girlfriend that looks like a 10, and by the time she's 30, she looks like a 2. So if I really need to spell out that analogy for you, this will look the same for a very long time because it's bed liner. It's very durable. If you use regular paint, unless you're really dainty with your hands, since it was painted from factory, it's probably going to chip and flake again because everyone's panels I see that are painted tend to get scratched up easily because it's paint. Again, I'm going to say there's a reason why we don't paint interior panels anymore. And cars from factory that are, PT Cruisers, Beetles, some BMWs, those panels, Porsches, the panels that are painted, just look like ass over time. I'm sorry. The clutch engagement point on the 350 is very high. That's just how it is. Right, TJ? For the clutch on these cars, the engagement point is just very high. I'm assuming that it's mainly because it's more oriented for sport driving. If you think about it, if your engagement point is at the top, you don't have to push the pedal down as far, you can engage that clutch very quickly. The 350 is technically a hatchback, so you can tell your parents that you're actually the more sensible person out of your group of friends. What you don't tell them though is any kind of box that you try to put in the car, nothing really fits. The hardest thing to service on a 350, if I were to pick any regular maintenance item, are the lights. Whether it be the headlights, the signal lights up front, or if you wanted to change out, if you're just changing out the bulbs in the rear, you can take out the rear tail lights. You have to be careful with those push pins, but if you want to change out the housings, you're probably going to end up taking off the rear bumper shell. For the center gauges, you'll notice that you have temperature on here. Unfortunately, Nissan did not give the option to just flick a switch or go into the options and go from Imperial or the English system to metric. So if you have, this is mainly for people in Canada, because I noticed where I live, like every 350 out here is American. If you are looking to convert this to Celsius, then you probably want to convert this to Celsius, because I just don't know how to read Fahrenheit up until now. And the only way to do that is you have to buy new gauges here, and you have to get the metric version of these gauges, because this gets its information from this guy. So you can put a metric version in here. The temperature will read in Celsius, but it'll be wrong. And also the speedo on here, you can have this as speed, it's going to be wrong as well. It still will work, but the only way to do the to have it convert mathematically is you have to change out the cluster as well. The car is not equipped with automatic headlights. However, it does have battery rundown protection, so if you take out the keys, you lock the car, these lights will eventually shut off, so that way you don't drain the battery. The 350 is better than the RX-8 because it doesn't spend two-thirds of its life in the shop. Well guys, hopefully you enjoyed this video, we had some fun with it. Comment below if there's other things about the car that I missed that you know about. At the end of the day, we're all car guys and girls. This is a great car. It is not flawless, obviously. And at the end of the day, every vehicle has their quirks, whether it be oil consumption, or there are things that wear out on the suspension on some other cars, or, you know, it just has a rotary in it. I'm sorry, rotary fans. I know, I give you guys a hard time. It's just that there's no RX-8s on the road anymore, and every time I see one, it's only in the garage. But to see what else I'm up to, check out my Instagram and Facebook, AnthonyJ350, and also check out our website at www.gofasthavefun.ca. Yeah.